diagnosed and has had his initial surgery. And I said, oh, that's very interesting. And there was this guy standing next to me during this conversation, and it turned out to be Josh. And he said, oh, well, this is the patient here. and so what that started was really an odyssey, which we're still on. I think the fundamental kind of theme behind what we're doing and what we've been doing for the last 2 years is to try to figure out how to, as rapidly as possible, go from some of the model systems that you heard talked about, the most reductionist model systems, that is, or cells, to patients as rapidly as possible, circumventing as much of the traditional drug discovery process as possible. Fundamentally, what this comes down to is being able to test as many hypotheses in parallel as possible. And the way one does this is the same way that one would do it in any other field, which is that instead of doing things in series, that is, you test things once at a time, you test everything simultaneously in a single experiment. And I think Simone asked me to bring these because I think they are sort of illustrative, that there's some of these that are hanging around, and I think David Alcorta actually washed these out last night. So as far as I know, there's nothing toxic or living in these things, but I still would not lick them or use them as eating utensils or anything. But what they are is what we do our experiments in, and it's a plate that has 1,536 wells in it. They hold about 1,000 cells each. You can look at these. What we ideally would like to do is to take each patient with a chordoma and stick them into one of those wells and pour a drug on top and see how they respond, but a tad impractical. So what we do instead of that is to take the cells out of the body, put them into those wells, and put the drugs on top and see how they respond. And there's a number of issues associated with that. That, of course, if you take the cells out of the body, as some of the previous speakers have said, they stop responding in the way that they might, at least potentially, might in the body. And you also have to, as David was saying, you have to make sure that the cells are what they're said to be. But the point is that one can test, and we're able to test, and have been testing every drug that's been approved, not only by FDA, but every regulatory agency worldwide in a day using this kind of technology. So we do it using robots like this. So let me I'll take heart in hand here and hope that it doesn't crash the computer again. What you're seeing here is, think of these robot arms as essentially researchers or postdocs or graduate students or technicians, and what they're doing is they're handing plates back and forth to each other, and in the back we can hold about 4 or 5 million wells of compounds. In the middle, there are tissue culture incubators. These sort of gen air looking things in the middle are like Chordoma Foundation pointer. These are tissue culture incubators that keep the cells warm and happy. And then at this end, there are so-called readers, which are essentially glorified microscopes that allow you to assess whether the drugs are doing what you want them to do on the cells. And in this case, what we want the compounds to do, the drugs to do, is very simple. We want them to kill them. So it's a very simple assay. We do a lot of more complicated ones, but in this assay, it's pretty simple. Okay, so I'm now going to try to quick get out of this and hopefully get to. So we're going to have some fun with this because this is going to do a PC to Mac transition. And any of you know who are in the computer world know them's fighting words. So we'll see how this goes. This may, who knows? Maybe there'll be new data here that we'll discover. God knows. Okay, so So this is this. So the concept here is that rather than discovering a new drug in the way that I'll show you in a second, what we're actually working on is to take drugs that are currently approved for other uses and find which ones might be useful in chordoma. And the reason we're taking this approach with chordoma, and I can be, I think, straightforward with this crowd, is that the conventional drug discovery process, which I think is on this slide, right, this process takes 10 to 15 years. And when I first talked to Simone and Josh about this, their reaction was, well, that doesn't apply to what we need, because the life expectancy in our disease is 4 years, 5 years, less than 15. So what else can we do? And so we had been thinking about this, taking this approach, but I must, for other reasons, but I must say that the conversation that I had with these two 3 years ago really gave us a boost working in this direction. But so let me just tell you how drug discovery normally works, and then I'm going to try to distinguish that from what we're doing. So normally what one does is you study the basic biology of a system for a long time. And the first talk about the notochord is a perfect example. I grew up in the same world of developmental biology. And you're studying a fundamental mechanism usually, and then you frequently, as was described there, you stumble across an application of what you're doing which you really didn't anticipate. But you might also identify a target, and that what we mean by a target is usually a gene or a protein which acts as a pressure point in a regulatory system, in a system which regulates whether a cell's growing or not and whether it remembers what it's supposed to be. And you can think about this as a lever in a system of other levers, and you push this one to bring the system back in balance again. And so that's really what a target is. And so what you're doing is you're trying to identify a drug, a small molecule compound, which can act on that target to either increase its activity or decrease its activity and bring the system back to where the balance is supposed to have. And normally what we do, and probably 80% of what we do or 90% of what we do at our place and how typical drug development is done, is that you create an assay system, and we've been doing this a lot of this in chordoma, that is a testing system that allows you to test 4 to 5 million tests in a week. That's a typical drug development project. It's not what we're doing at chordoma, but it's a typical project. So you're testing greater than 100,000 chemicals on an individual target for its activity, and then you do a lot of medicinal chemistry to try to make modifications of these molecules to make them suitable for initial animal use and then human use. And then eventually you get into humans. And this whole process, you've probably heard, those of you who know about this whole process takes around 10 to 15 years, including costs of failures. This is about $1 billion to get from here to here. And so for a lot of diseases, you really have to go this route. But I would argue that we want to go this route eventually in chordoma too, but the problem is we really don't know what the targets are in chordoma. And so in that case, one simply asks a more practical question. Well, what do we know about chordoma? What we know about chordoma is they have a certain cell type and they grow too much. So the issue is, can you get that cell out and make them stop growing or kill them? It's pretty simple in principle. Okay, so what's the center that I run in Mahang? Has really done all the work here, so I get to, as usual, I get to stand up and present talk that other people do. That's what we all do. I think there's one person who actually does work so far that's actually given a presentation so far. So anyway, it's about 65 people. We've had 100 collaborations, a bunch of them with foundations, and fundamentally, what we do is bring the things that the kinds of technologies that go on in biotechnology and pharmaceutical organizations to rare neglected diseases and academic or government drug discovery. So this is another way to put that last chart I just gave you here. If you sort of break this down into the sort of vernacular of the field, the if you start with a target at one end and you want to get the FDA at the other, the conventional way that this is done is you start out with about 300,000 compounds. It takes about 10 to 15 years to go from here to here. What we're trying to do here is to take all the drugs that are approved by FDA, take them back to a screen, and then try to get back to a clinical trial within a year or two. That's the idea. Okay, so I don't want to go through this in detail, but just to show you what the numbers are, two informatics people and two compound acquisition chemistry people at our place have spent the last 3 years putting together the largest collection in the world of approved drugs. So we have everything that's been approved by FDA, UK, EU, Canada, Japan. These are a number of compounds which are in clinical trials, haven't been approved yet. And that number is about 3,000, and it's growing all the time. And this was an enormous both informatics challenge and a procurement challenge. These compounds are often very expensive. Some of them we had to synthesize ourselves, or have them synthesized in China. I still have my medical license, so I was able to write prescriptions to obtain some of these, and then we purified them out of the tablets. And the group that does this is very unusual for an academic group. This is what a pharmaceutical or a biotech company looks like, but it's very unusual for an academic organization. That is, it has biologists, chemists, informatics people, computer scientists people, and robotics people who run that beast, like I showed you at the beginning. And this is the other thing that's unusual, is that these are some of the places that these folks come from. About 80% of the people who are at the center come from pharma and biotech, so we know how to do this. Mahang and I were both at Merck before, but there's many other companies that these folks come from, and it brings a knowledge of how to very practically move the kinds of discoveries that you heard about before into the drug development world very efficiently. Okay, so this is actually a picture of the robot that you saw in the video. It's about the size of this room. It's about the size of a small school bus, and it can do about 4 million tests in a week. So we work on a lot of rare and neglected diseases. You notice some of them are rare, like Chordoma and Gaucher and Huntington's. Some of them are neglected, like diseases in the developing world. And this is really, I'm not going to show you a lot of data. I just want to give you a sense of the approach. So this is the headway that we've made so far. So this was initiated officially in 2006. It's really and what was required to do this. And again, it sounds like a broken record from other speakers, but it's really important to say that you can't underestimate the role of the Chordoma Foundation in doing this. The reason that when Josh and Simone and I first sat down to do this, what I told them was that, you know, I personally know a lot about Chordoma because I used to treat patients. I'm a neurologist, but Mahang is not. Most of my scientists are not. We're not Chordoma experts. If we're going to do this, you have to put together a brain trust of Chordoma researchers who can help us pick the right cells, pick the right outcomes, be able to follow up the results. And that drug discovery team was assembled by the foundation. We screened a bunch of cell lines, some of which you've heard about before. This was the line that a number of folks have talked about before. And we're looking at cell killing. We've just started to initiate screening primary cells directly from patients as opposed to cell lines, and we can get into what that means if you're interested. There's 2,816 approved drugs that have been screened at multiple concentrations over about a 10,000-fold range of dose. As you know, dose is important as to the effect of a drug. And we're now in the follow-up stage, in addition to doing ongoing screening here. And what we're trying to do is define what is the shortest path from a cell-based screen, which is necessarily artificial, to a person. And the goal here is to get to patients by the end of the year. That's quite ambitious, but I actually think we can do it. And this is the kind of really straightforward data you get out of this. What we're looking at here is all a bunch of different cell lines and a bunch of different compounds. And these are the Chordoma lines here. I just show you this to give you a sense of how complicated these data are. And the way you deal with these data is you do the experiment in as robust a way as you can, and then you work with experts to go to other model systems, whether they be in cells or animals or what have you, as xenograft models, in order to validate the results that we get in something that is intermediate in complexity between a cell and a dish and a person. Okay, so I'm just going to, I'd be glad to take any questions about this, but I just want to stress at the end that this is a, this team really is a team. I mean, we have a team at the NCGC who works on this, but Michael, David, Neil Spector have been critical in this, particularly Michael and David and Josh when he was in Michael's lab. Derek Park, who's at the University of Pittsburgh, who's talked, I think, earlier and will talk later today. Larry Baker at Michigan, Andrew Wagner, and the folks from the Chordoma Foundation. We get together on the phone very regularly to discuss these results and really hash through them. We met again yesterday afternoon. And one of the real pleasures for me in this has been to be able to work with these folks who are just incredibly committed to doing something for this disease, and I'm very confident that we're gonna be able to make some headway, and I hope hopefully in the next 6 months we'll be able to give you more definitive information. So I'll stop there.